So when we talk about what causes myocarditis, the inflammation of our heart muscle, so myocarditis or pericarditis, inflammation of the outside lining of our heart, we can think about two main causes or etiologies. It can be either of an infectious cause, infectious, meaning a microorganism like a bacterium or a virus or a fungus or something like that. Or it could be non-infectious. Non-infectious, pretty intuitive, right? But from here, we'll make some other distinctions about what we mean when we say non-infections. That's not as obvious as what I'm putting here. So it's either infectious or non-infectious, and I'll talk about the main causes that fall under each of these categories. And we'll start up here with myocarditis. And in fact, the number one or the most common cause of myocarditis in, and I'll just write here the first world. So the most common cause in the first world or the developed worlds is a virus. It's a virus. And if you want to know the detail, this virus is specifically called the Coxsackie virus, Coxsackie, or sometimes it's called Coxsackie viridae. But the Coxsackie virus is the most common cause of myocarditis in first world countries. And for some reason, medical professionals like to make the distinction about the most common cause in South America, because it's an interesting sort of pathogen or interesting microorganism. Or so let's say, for instance, you just came back from watching a couple of soccer games in Brazil, maybe. And you've got this persistent chest pain, and we do a couple of tests, and we realize that there's an abnormal rhythm in your heart. And so over time, you find out that this person is infected with a protozoan, which is a different class of microorganism from a virus. And in fact, malaria is a type of protozoan, but it's not the one I'm talking about here. The specific protozoan that's involved with myocarditis from South America is known as Trypanosoma cruzi, and maybe you know it better by its disease name. This is Chagas disease, and Chagas disease does not only involve myocarditis, but you also get an infection of the esophagus and other parts of your body. So it's this constellation of signs that would lead physicians to start thinking that maybe it's Chagas disease instead of a typical viral myocarditis that we commonly see in the States. And then a final infectious cause of myocarditis I should mention here. I'll just write this is an important cause of myocarditis. And this is a type of bacterium. This is a bacterium. And the specific genus and species of this bacterium is called Borrelia, with two R's, Borrelia, and then this species name is a lot of fun to pronounce. Burgdorferi. Borrelia burgdorferi, which you may more readily recognize as the disease Lyme disease, especially if you're from Lyme, Connecticut, where it was first described. So Lyme disease is also something that can lead to myocarditis, but mind you, this is advanced Lyme disease. Early on, you'd get more of the skin signs that are classically associated with that and some arthritis, but myocarditis can eventually occur if you have what's called chronic Lyme disease. So let's skip on down here to our non-infectious causes. The first one I'd want to mention for myocarditis is idiopathic. Idiopathic. And what does that mean exactly? Well, the way I remember it is that an idiopathic cause is one that makes us feel like idiots because we can't actually figure out what it is. So idiopathic means the cause of a disease that is unknown. So I'll write in parentheses here a question mark. So idiopathic myocarditis is myocarditis of an unknown origin. But because a virus is so overwhelmingly the likely cause of myocarditis, some physicians will just chalk up idiopathic myocarditis to just be likely viral in origin. So it's likely a viral myocarditis. In fact, some literature suggests that about 50% of all myocarditis is idiopathic, and that most likely just is viral. All right, so let's move on to our next cause right here. And this is a disorder. It's an immune system disorder that's called rheumatic fever. Rheumatic fever. And rheumatic fever is caused by a streptococcal infection. So I'll write a strep infection. So this could be something like strep throat. So strep infection. Or it could also be what's called streptococcemia, which just means a blood infection of streptococcus throughout your bloodstream. So this strep infection will then end up causing the immune system. So the immune system to make antibodies. And I'll abbreviate antibody as just AB. Antibodies that attack, that end up attacking your myocardium. And so rheumatic fever is a big deal, because if it's not caught, this could potentially then be a life-threatening disorder that attacks the heart muscle. And this actually is something that we are more concerned about in developing countries, where we don't always treat a sore throat strep infection. In the States, if you have a sore throat that lasts long enough, people are more likely to go to the doctor and get an antibiotic for that. So other than that, there's also a couple of drugs or substances that you can take that are what's called cardiotoxic. Cardiotoxic, and as the term suggests, that means that they're no good for the heart. And there are a bunch of things that are cardiotoxic, such as cocaine, which honestly is no good for any part of the body. If you abuse alcohol, if you take in too much alcohol in a short period of time or over years and years of consumption, that can be cardiotoxic. There's also carbon monoxide poisoning, which is something to be concerned about if you fall asleep in a garage with a car on. Carbon monoxide poisoning can lead to myocarditis. And then certain chemo drugs or chemotherapy drugs that were used more commonly in the past can also cause myocarditis. And I'll give you an example of one of them. It's called doxorubicin. Doxorubicin is known to be associated with myocarditis in some people, but not all the time. So these are just some of the drugs or substances that you can take that can be myocardiotoxic, if you want to be that specific. But then finally, there are also some systemic diseases. So I'll write systemic diseases that can target the myocardium to cause inflammation there. These include things like lupus, which is a disorder where you make a bunch of antibodies against parts of your body that should not be attacked by the immune system, but are. And so that can cause myocarditis. There's another disorder that's called sarcoidosis, where you have granulation tissue or inflammation tissue. It's another term for inflammation. Granulation tissue setting down in the myocardium, causing inflammation there. And there's another disorder that's called systemic sclerosis or scleroderma. All right, scleroderma right here, which is when you have the connective tissue protein collagen being made in tissues that it shouldn't be made that commonly. So sometimes you'll see an excess amount of collagen be made in the skin, making your skin very tight. Sometimes it's made around the esophagus, making it difficult to swallow. And sure enough, scleroderma can also deposit a bunch of collagen in your myocardium to cause myocarditis as well.